Okay, thanks a lot. Well, first of all, let me apologize for not being able to attend. It's really a pity because I'm sure that the workshop is great, and it's a pity that I'm not there. At the same time, I would like to thank the organizers for setting up this amazing online streaming, etc. I've been following some of the talks, and it's great to be able to give this talk through Skype. So going directly to the talk, what I want to discuss today is a simple model that we have developed to describe the possibility of global precession in the disk that is formed after a TDE. This is mainly the work done by my student, Alessia Franchini, who is here beside me. And it's done in collaboration also with Stefano Pacchini. We have a paper that is now in press in Monthly Notices, and you can also check it online. There is the AstroPH number. So I'm sure you've already discussed the importance that the spin of the black hole might have in the dynamics of TDEs, because in general, of course, TDEs involve stars which are on orbits that are inclined with respect to the spin of the black hole. And I'm sure that Hayasaki earlier in this conference has already discussed the effects that the lens steering precession might have in delaying the formation of the disk. This has also been discussed by Enrico and James in a recent paper. I'm not concerned with the disk formation, but I want to discuss whether after the disk has formed, whether we can observe global disk precession in this case, which might result in some observed periodicity in the early TDE life curve. Now, this work is a kind of a follow-up to some work that has already been done, and especially I think the important paper in this case is the one by Stone and Lowe, so they have already discussed a little bit this issue. Now, in this talk, in this model, what we are going to do is essentially produce a simple model to link the possible observables, such as the precession rate and decay timescale of the precession, with the fundamental parameters of the black hole, in particular to their masses and spin. Now I'm stuck. Hold on. Okay. One thing to say is whether sometimes in the literature it's been suggested that in this kind of events we should observe the Bardeen-Patterson effect. Here I would like to make a distinction between the possibility of having Bardeen-Patterson effect or global precession. Now, well, there is one paper in particular, Lei et al., that attributes a periodic signal to the Bardeen-Patterson effect, and in particular they have applied it to the kind of a dubious period of roughly 2.7 days, which has been kind of seen in SWIFT J1644. However, it's important to remember that the Bardeen-Patterson effect occurs when the disk is very thin and viscous, and in this case what happens is that the innermost part of the disk aligns with the black hole. Are you still listening? Okay, thank you. Okay. I was just wondering whether you were online because I had a notice that the connection was lost, but that's okay. So I was just saying that in this viscous case, the innermost part of the disk aligns with the black hole, and the outermost parts keep their original misalignment, and this generally does not lead to any kind of precession, not of the disk, nor of the black hole spin, of course. So if the Bardeen-Patterson effect occurs, there is no regular precession. Regular precession is instead observed in the opposite case, where the disk is thick and viscid. So in particular, when the viscosity parameter, if you want to describe it as an alpha disk, is less than the aspect ratio H over R. because we need to be in under this condition that the warp propagates as a wave in the disk, and this is what is necessary to have a rigid precession. But in particular, this is what occurs in TDE disks. We expect our disks to be thick, and therefore we expect this condition to be satisfied for TDEs. A second condition which is necessary in order to have a regular precession is that the wave propagation time across the disk be shorter than the shortest precession period due to Lenz theory precession. And that's the condition that I've written down there. And also this is typically satisfied in TDE disk because these disks are narrow. So in general, if you want to have a rigid body precession, you need to have a thick and narrow disk. And these are exactly the conditions that we expect in TDEs. So, indeed, even if we don't have the Bardeen-Peterson effect, we should be able to have global precession in these cases. What we can do to model this phenomenon is, for example, do something that has been done sometimes in the context of QPOs in X-ray binaries. Now it's easy to demonstrate that if the whole disk precesses rigidly, the precession rate should be given by this formula here, which is essentially a weighted average of the various length steering precession rates across the disk, which are weighted with L, which is the angular momentum per unit area in the disk. Now, this precession frequency here depends in a non-trivial way on the various parameters because, well, we have the explicit dependence on M and A of the length steering rate. But on top of that, we also have that the inner and outer radius of the disk under which we average do depend on the spin and the mass. Here we assume that the inner disk radius is the E square, which depends on A, and that the outer disk radius is two times the tidal radius, that depends on M. So there is a kind of a complex dependence on the various parameters. Just a note, here we just assume the disruption of the solar type star on a parabolic orbit, so that the most standard TDE disruption. In order to compute omega p, we also need to specify L as a function of radius, which requires to have sigma. And for that, we simply take an approximation to the Slindis model that has been developed by Strube and Quatert and has been applied in some cases by me and Elena in a paper, and also by Nick in his paper about Lenz theory precession. So we use this very same model that they used in their paper. So the first thing that we can do is to simply plug in the numbers as a function of the spin and the mass of the black hole and see what precession periods we get. And that is what we get. Here is the period as a function of the spin. We have prograde and retrograde orbits. And the various lines here, the solid lines, refer to various masses of the black hole. The green is 10 to the 5 solar masses, the red is 10 to the 6, and the black is 10 to the 7 solar masses. Now, again, if we want to, for example, refer to the 2.7-day period observed in J1644, whether you believe it or not, it's just an example, that would be 3 days, so 3 days is more or less there, in which case you could see that, for example, we would have either a massive black hole with a 10 to the 7 solar mass and a spin of roughly 0.7, or if we want to go for a lower black hole mass, which is probably more likely in this case, let's say 10 to the 6 solar masses, then this would argue for an extremely highly spinning black hole, almost maximally spinning. So that's one way in which we can use the observed period to get some insight on the black hole. That if you go too low in the black hole mass, then we can't reproduce very fast periodicities, like for example just a few days. In general, the periods that we expect are between a few days and a few weeks, depending on the various parameters. However, as we can see here, we have a degeneracy. So, for example, if we just have the period of the precession, this can correspond to different spins and black hole masses. So we should find a way, we should have another observable in order to disentangle the two and to break the degeneracy. And this might actually be given by, for example, considering the damping of the oscillations. Because, of course, we don't expect this precession to last for very long. There are several effects that might lead to damping. The first one is due to the fact that the disk evolves with time and thins with time. That's because, well, if the radiation pressure dominated regime, h over r scales with m dot, and since m dot declines with time, h over r also declines, and eventually we will move into the regime, into the viscous propagation regime for the warp, so that the Bardeen-Peterson effect occurs and the precession dumps out. The second possibility is that actually, even if we stay in the wavelength propagation regime, still we have dissipation, still we have viscosity, and this would cause alignment even in this case, independently of the fact that the disk thins because of the declining m dot. Now, the first of these two effects has been already investigated by Nick. So in their paper, they predict that there is a specific time. This is what I call here T thin. This time is the time needed to move into the Bardeen-Peterson effect, and they argue that the oscillation should, the precession should decay by that time. It's interesting to notice that in this case, the time scale scales with the alpha viscosity to the minus 3 thin. Okay, that's a specific prediction for this kind of process. In the opposite case, if viscous alignment occurs, then the alignment time has been given by several authors, Beketal and Foucault and La in particular, and up to some order of unity factors is given by the formula that is shown here, and one can see that it depends on alpha to the minus 1. So if we were able to check the behavior as a function of alpha, we can easily disentangle between the two and check whether the decay time scales as alpha to the minus 3/5 or as alpha to the minus 1, which are the two different regimes. So that's what we try to do, and in order to do that, we have run a number of simple numerical simulations. These are very simple models, 1D models, so we just take a series of rings and solve for the wave propagation equation, which is described here. This is from a paper by Lugo and Ogilvy. This describes the evolution of waves in the linear regime. It's a bit of a complex set of equations, but it can be solved numerically. Before going to the results, let me give you a few definitions. Here, the small l is the unit vector parallel to the angular momentum of the disk. Lx and Ly are the misaligned components of L. So if these are non-zero, we have a misalignment. And we can use a complex notation, which is described here, and we define two angles, beta and phi. Now, beta is the inclination angle of each ring, and phi is the phase that indicates how much, it essentially indicates the rotation of the inclined ring. So if beta is a function of R, we have a warp. If phi is a function of r, we also have a twist. Okay. Now, in these simulations, we do assume that the h over r evolves with time, with m dot. We assume that m dot scales as t to the minus 5/3 as usual. And we check, then we evolve our system, and we check whether we do see global precession and the time scale it takes to decline. Now, let me show you an example here. This is a movie. I hope that the movie plays. If we have global precession, here in the movie I'm showing two panels. The top panel is beta, the bottom panel is phi. So the top panel shows the tilt, and if you have solid body precession, we would expect this tilt to evolve to a constant. Okay, it shouldn't be a function of time. On the other hand, the phi should be a function of time, should just be a constant rotation, so it should evolve in this way, and essentially in this kind of plot, it should just drift up and down between minus pi and pi. Now, here I'm taking just a standard initial condition. We have tried with several initial conditions, it doesn't change. Basically, what happens now, I'm playing the movie, we have an initial transient after after a while, after the transient is gone, then you see that the shape of the disk stays constant with time, and the phase, as I mentioned, drifts up and down between minus pi half and pi half. Okay, so this clearly shows that in this particular case, we do have a rigid body precession. Now, that's just one example, but in general, we have noticed that for essentially all the parameters that we have taken, rigid body precession does occur. Out of this, now you can't notice in this movie because the decay of the warp is very, very slow, but indeed, what happens is that as time goes on, the warp decays. And so we can track this decay. And these are a couple of examples. Now again, I'm fixing the period to the 2.7 day period, just to make an example. And I'm showing the results for a 10 to the 6 solar mass in the left panel, and for a 10 to the 7 solar mass in the right panel. And the two, of course, are different. A, we have an almost maximal spinning, let's call in the left, and a moderate spin in the right. And here we can already see two things. First of all, if you want to fix the observed period, say in this case 3 days, a larger black hole mass requires a smaller spin, okay, 0.7 versus 0.9. But the other most interesting thing that we notice is that if the black hole mass is larger, look at the right, and the spin is lower, this implies a much longer alignment time. If you see, for the 10 to the 6 solar mass case, the precession decays after just a few periods, while in the 10 to the 7 solar mass case, it lasts for much longer. This is essentially due to the fact that when the black hole mass is smaller, the radial extent of the disk is much larger. So it's much harder to keep rigid body precession over a very, very wide disk. For a larger black hole mass, the disk is narrower, and it's much easier to keep rigid precession. So, this, as I was mentioning, might be a way to break the degeneracy between mass and spin of the black hole if we not only measure the period of the precession, but also the number of oscillations before alignment. Now, the final question is whether the decay is due to viscous damping or to the thinning of the disk as predicted by Stone and Loeb. And we have run a number of simulations as a function of the various parameters. We have changed spin, mass, and alpha. And these are the results that we obtain. On the left, we have the low-mass black hole. On the right, we have a high-mass black hole. In both cases, the spin is moderate. We have a 0.6 value of A. The points are the results of the computed alignment time from our simulations. And the two lines show just two different slopes, alpha to the minus 1 in red and alpha to the minus 3/5 in black. You can see that actually the results align perfectly with the alpha to the minus 1. So clearly the decay is due to viscous dissipation and not by the fact that the disk is spinning. Now this happens in this particular case for a moderate spin. The situation is slightly more complicated if we decrease the spin. Now, here the spin is 0.2, okay, which implies much longer precession times. And here, as you can see, the points do not align perfectly, neither with the point with a minus 1 or minus 3/5. But it's interesting. Now, let's focus on the left, so 10 to the 6 solar mass. If you look carefully, there is a hint that there is a steeper slope for higher alpha and a shallower slope for lower alpha. And actually, here is again another version of the same plot where I superimposed an alpha to the minus 3/5 for low alpha and an alpha to the minus 1 for high alpha. In this case, actually, I believe that we are in the regime where for high alpha we have viscous dissipation and for low alpha is the thinning that determines the damping of the oscillation. In general, we have fitted the alignment time scale as a function of alpha, and we have computed the slope, and here is the result that we have. Now in this plot I show S, this is the slope of the previous plots, as a function of the spin, and the various line refers to the various black hole masses. As you can see, for spins larger than 0.4, the slope is almost identical to 1, which essentially says that it is viscosity that drives the damping. thinning is only important for very low values of the spin below 0.4, which, you know, one might argue whether they can be observed or not. And in particular, for higher black hole masses, we reach the thinning regime more easily than for the low black hole masses. So I'm now almost done. Here are my conclusions. From our calculations, we show that essentially throughout the parameter space, a disk that is formed after the disruption of a star around the spinning black hole can globally precess. The precessional period depends on spin and mass of the black hole in a relatively simple way. You can look at the plots that I showed in one of the first slides. But also the alignment time depends on the mass and the spin. So if one can observe both the global precession and its decay, then one can easily constrain both parameters. The process that leads to alignment is mostly viscous dissipation within the disk, and it's not related to the thinning which leads into the Parkin-Patterson effect as initially proposed by Stone and Loeb, except for possibly the lowest values of the spin. Now there are a number of caveats. Well, evidently, the model that we have produced is very simple. We haven't gone into a detailed modeling of the disk structure. We have just assumed this approximation to the slim disk by Stroop and Quater, which is fine, but maybe one can do the same exercise for more complex disk configuration. I should say that we based all our alignment timescale calculation on the linear warp propagation. But this is, I think, relatively okay because the warp that you observe is rather small. So the propagation becomes non-linear, not if the inclination is large, but if the warp is large. And we predict only a modest warp in the disk. In this model, we don't use any NHD to model the viscosity. We just assume that there is a simple Shapiro Swinnerack prescription. Of course, one can argue that the situation might be slightly different if we have MHD an MHD process providing this viscosity. But the idea here was just to model a very large parameter space. We don't want to run a specific simulation for a given spin and black hole mass. We just wanted to explore as much as possible and for as long as possible, because we also want to check the alignment over a wide parameter space. And currently, I think only this kind of modeling is feasible to explore the wide parameters that we have. And I think this is all I wanted to say, and thank you for your attention. Yes? Oh, hi. Nice to see you. Okay. Yes, thank you. That's exactly one of the limitations that I mentioned at the end. And I agree, and in general, I agree perfectly with you that if you have MHD, then the stress is not going to be isotropic as alpha models imply. So yes, indeed, this is one way to go. Of course, the reason why we haven't done this MHD calculation is essentially because what I told you is we wanted to explore the parameter space. I should say that I don't think this is going to affect much our prediction for the precession rates that do not depend on viscosity at all. Possibly, I think there is going to be some change in the alignment time. I agree about that. And of course, it would be worth going on and do some MHP simulations as you have done. Here, really, the aim is to have a broad parameter space, and I really, computation is not that easy to run these many simulations. But I do agree with you. I'm just worried that your simulations, as well as Chris's previous one, they are certainly the way to go. I mean, you have to do the full GR with MHD, you have to do everything. But at the same time, one incurs into the risk of, because of all the various physical effects that enter into play, one might lose track of what is actually the most important physical process that leads, for example, to alignment. Okay. Indeed, actually, if you look at the Bate criterion, for example, the Bate alignment time, it does depend on the precession rate. I'm sure in the end, it's the less steering torque that does that provides the torque that you're talking about. Yes, but this occurs for nonlinear works. I completely agree with your description, but the radial velocities are order sonic only if the work is nonlinear. And I do agree that that's another thing that I mentioned. If the work becomes nonlinear, then certainly you might have a different alignment times. I completely agree with you. But again, here, the nonlinearity of the warp is not that the inclination is large, but is that the warp is large. So you have to have a large difference in inclination between the inner and outer radius of the disk, which is what we don't see in our simulation. So we are not in the nonlinear regime. Thank you, and bye-bye.